especially we want to focus in gender, in thinking about how to realize our constitutional right to an environment that's not harmful to our health or well-being. So not only at the CR do we recognize and celebrate the work of female activists in the environmental justice movement, but we're working to try and transform the burdens faced by women in this sector. So for this webinar today, I'm joined by some of my colleagues in the Activist Support and Training Program, as well as five movers and shakers who are environmental and gender activists and leaders who are making the change that we need in our society. I'm very excited to hear their thoughts and their reflections, and also as an attorney in the civil society sector, to try and ensure that our own legal and advocacy and litigation strategies support the work of these incredible women. I'm going to hand over to my colleague, Tobeka Gumede, who is a fellow attorney in the Activist Support and Training Program. And after Tobeka, I will introduce our speakers before their presentations. Thanks so much. Over to you, Tobeka.
Thank you very much, Danny. Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to our webinar. So I'm just going to give an overview of why we are all here today. Why did we decide to have this women's focused webinar? And despite the fact that it is Women's Month, and obviously we want to celebrate the amazing work that has been done by our women activists, I think it's also important for me to highlight that the Center for Environmental Rights has always been conscious of the need to actively advance gender equality, to support women activists, and to empower the leadership of women within our work. So we are aware of the gender inequalities and the power dynamics in our society, but specifically also in our environmental justice movement. And because of this, we try by all means to apply a gender lens in our work. So applying a gender lens in environmental justice means that we are considerate of the constraints and also of the possibilities of the different social factors that relate to the environment, right? The roles and responsibilities that they are expected, or people are expected to fulfill because of this, and the resources they have access to and control over. Okay, and having this understanding gives us insights into the different kind of dynamics that are faced by different people. It also gives us an understanding of the kind of support that is required, or that we are required to give to the people that we work with. I'll give you a few examples of how we try to advance gender equality in our organization, but more specifically in our program, Activist Support and Training. So as you all know, we run a Rights and Remedy School every year. And as part of the curriculum, we decided to then include sessions on gender. So here we really try to encourage participants to confront some of the conditionings, cultural and societal conditionings, that may be perpetuating gender inequalities without even them being aware of that. And we try to also encourage them to be intentional about being inclusive, being transformational, and just having a safe space for everyone to be able to work within their own organizations. So in addition to these rights and remedy sessions, we also ran a few trainings on gender and sexual harassment. We try to encourage different community-based organizations to also develop sexual harassment policies, because we cannot deny or shy away from the fact that these things do happen even within our own organizations. We cannot speak of environmental justice without addressing or tackling gender injustices. So we are very happy to have our panelists here today, some of which are our Rights and Remedies graduates, to just tell us more about their lived experiences, the work that they do, you know, so that we have insights on how they navigate the different challenges that they face as women activists. We are also grateful to have Dr. Mutse, who's our gender expert. I've had the privilege of working with her over the years. So Dr. Mutse, I'm really hoping that she'll be able to give us some insights, you know, on how to make this space better for our women activists. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much for setting that tone to Becca, and a reminder that yes, we spoke speaking about the challenges and the burdens, and hopefully talking about what sort of support is needed, but this is also a place to celebrate and to just express our absolute pride in the work of the activists who when they do great work, we see their work, we celebrate, and this is a platform for us also to just acknowledge that incredible contribution. Thank you so much, everybody, for writing who you are in the chat. Feel free to say hi. And if you have questions or comments, you're most welcome to use the chat as well. And my colleagues will make sure that they get to me, and we will have an opportunity for some questions and answers after our panelists have given a brief presentation. And I'm now going to move on to our first speaker. Katlego, are you ready? We've got Katlego Malesa. Katlego is the project coordinator of Sekukune Combined Mining Affected Communities, as well as the deputy secretary of Mining and Environmental Justice Community Network of South Africa, also known as MEJCON. Katlego was part of the 2018 Rights and Remedies cohort, and in 2022, she was nominated as an unsung hero by the Sunday World under the category of Youth in Environment and Sustainability. Katlego is an activist, and as an activist, she has been part of so many campaigns, engagements, and projects that seek to advance environmental justice. Katlego, thank you so much for joining us. It's really great to be able to catch up with you and to hear your thoughts and reflections on your experiences. I believe you may have a presentation. You're welcome to share it. Otherwise, let us know if you need help with that as well. Katlego, are you there?
Yes, I am here.
Fabulous. Here. Take it away.
Thank you for.
Just to note, while I'm coming to you from Cape Town in our office, our community activists are home and may experience some technical or Wi-Fi or reception challenges. So just give us a moment to make sure that we can hear Katlego.
Hello, my good afternoon, everybody. And thank
Great.
You for having me. Yes. I don't have a presentation, but I did have something in IT that I did. So I can share that with you afterwards. But now, can I just be able to introduce myself and tell you where I come from? Yes, my name is Katlego Malesa. I'm from Sekukune, Burgersfort in Limpopo, at a village named Damakgopa. We are under the Vitakomotivas municipality, and I am a community activist that advocate the environment and the social also my organization is I'm a project coordinator. I coordinate most of the project in the organization. So I am here to share my experiences as a woman, the issues that I face in my day-to-day challenges as a woman, and also an activist in the rural areas. So if I can continue, the environmental issues in Sekukune that we face in the community is mostly lack of water and access to healthcare centers, which mostly is affecting the women's day-to-day activities, and the women are affected daily. In this sense, the reason I'm saying we are affected by the day-to-day challenges of water and access to healthcare is because women are mostly the workers of the household. They are mostly doing all the duties
Lejo, could I ask, perhaps could you turn your camera off, because it might improve the audio. We're struggling to hear you a little bit.
Okay. Okay,
Sorry
thank
to
you so
interrupt your
very much.
presentation.
Hi.
Hey, we're struggling to hear you. So if you could keep your
Hi,
camera
can you
off,
hear
I think we
me?
might. Yes, that's better. Thank you.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, that does seem better. You were explaining the burden of household responsibilities and healthcare problems and water. I think that's where we lost you a little bit from.
Yes, as I was saying, the most important thing is that when women lacks water, it's a very disturbing issue to some of the community members in the village, especially women, because without water, they cannot be able to run households, duties. They cannot be able to wash or even cook for the kids. In terms of the healthcare facilities, we are struggling with the healthcare facilities, which they are far, far apart from the communities. They are far, which we work at distance using our barefoot to get access to the healthcare. So that is also a very most challenging part of the activity as women in the village, whereby women get raped along the way to get access to the healthcare. Women also get raped along the way when they are going to fetch waters from the stream. So it's a very terrible challenge where it's affecting women's mentally, physically, where they cannot carry out some of the issues, they carry out some of the household duties due to lack of water, lack of health accessibility. So it is a very disturbing as a woman to not be able to have those kind of things available for us in the village. And it's also very dangerous for women to be walking around the bushes to fetch water. It's also risky also to walk with your child at the back going to access a health facility. So the other thing that it's a challenge and is very disturbing is the unemployment rate that we encounter in the villages, whereby mostly we have a women house heated homes, whereby most of the women are unemployed and they rely on children's grant to survive. So these women, some of them find solution in doing sex work as a way of sustaining their homes. And as they do the sex work, some of these get diseases, and you find out most of the percentages in the clinics are high because of the diseases, HIVs and AIDS, due to the sex working in terms of making sure that they want to sustain their homes. So we are just are also being affected terribly in terms of the environmental impact that we encounter, especially even the health. It's affecting our health, whereby the mining company do blast, and we get most of the people in the area getting respiratory problems. Remember, when we have high number of people getting respiratory problems, it's a chronic disease whereby we need to have access to health care nearby, where we'll be able to go to the clinic or the hospital to get medication. So those are the kind of frustration that women experience in the communities. We also have challenges that we are facing in the environmental justice network. As a woman, issues are actually not addressed in a way that I think it should be. My reason being that men don't actually understand the challenges and the pain that we go through that affect us daily in our lives. Because before I'm an activist, I'm a human, I'm a mother, I'm a wife. Where else, while doing the work on the ground, we also face our own personal challenges that affect us psychologically, physically, and mentally. So I tend to think that men in the our aspect of work don't really understand, and I think they should respect the women that they work across with in the same sector. And one should also not be kind of facing an issue of bullying in terms of the situation that maybe one is not beyond one's control. We put up with strong faces every day to make sure that our injustices are advocated. But then that doesn't mean I have to be bullied as a woman, because some feel that maybe Katlego is not meeting the needs of an activist, not forgetting that Katlego is also a person who's also having his own challenges and his own problems after being an activist. I think that we in the sector, we should respect each other's spaces, whereby one should not be feeling threatened by another person, or maybe one should not be feeling that he or she is being belittled in a way that one cannot be able to raise her voice in terms of the issues that she will be encountering in the environmental justice network. So I'm saying this in a sense that two years ago, I got pregnant, and we were busy doing the gender-based violent workshop across the provinces. So in that space, when I finished the work, went to two provinces, then afterwards I came back home. I stayed home about a week. I was pregnant in about 5 months. I was 5 months pregnant. Then I got miscarriage of 5 months of twins, of a set of twins, which I lost that pregnancy. And in that sense as well, I was emotionally drained after losing my pregnancies. But I hope I had a hope, and I had a feeling that people I work with should have an understanding of what I was going through. And in that case as well, I also got pregnant after the miscarriage. I fell pregnant again, as I felt is my duty as a woman to fulfill my duties as a woman who is married. I got pregnant again in the process of my pregnancy. I had a very disturbing pregnancy where I went in and out of hospital. I went in and out of hospital the where I wasn't able to execute some of the workshops in the Environmental Justice Network. So the reason I'm saying this, I want people to understand that we have different challenges that we face as women in the ground, working on the ground. And as a woman, I feel that we should also be respected and not be bullied. Some will not understand how I'm feeling, as this is emotionally draining for me as a woman, and for me as a wife at home, and also for me as an activist. One should feel that she should be supported by maybe colleagues that she works with, instead of not being feeling like she's bullied by one another, or being threatened, or maybe being a challenged in anyhow that one cannot be able to take it anymore. So I just feel that in terms of the issues that all the challenges that we encounter in the environmental justice network should always put a forefront of respect and not bully other women, not knowing where one is coming from, where all the issues that she's facing. Make sure that we understand each other's problems for us to be able to execute the work in the environmental justice network. So in terms of the challenges, addressing the challenges and finding a way to make sure that we reach common goals. So when I say we must make sure that we address the challenges and find a way to reach common goals, is that I just feel that we should have a space whereby we share, beside the work we do, we must also have a space for where we get a psychological wellness classes, where we are maybe being counseled, maybe being we have a counseling sessions where one should have a space for a free space where one should be able to address her personal issues, being able to make sure that in that space she is free to address every challenges that she as an activist she's facing on the ground. So we should have that space where we are being having a psychological wellness trainings for a space, especially for us women, in terms of our own issues, beside being an activist, beside being a monitor, beside being a project coordinator, but I also think that I need a space where I should also feel free to exercise the rights as women to be able to speak about the challenges that I face as a mother, beside being all of those things that I represent in the Environmental Justice Network. I also think that we should have more platforms to engage our issues of women and more programs that speak more especially about challenges that we face, might be at home or at work. Because I think that the spaces are not enough. We don't have more spaces where we talk about the challenges we face at home or even at our very respective working places. We just focus more on providing what is necessary from maybe what the funders will be looking for, but not specifically focusing on who is doing the work. What effects does it do to a woman when that woman is facing a trauma through their homes or maybe through the sessions that maybe will be providing assistance in the community? So we also find that there is challenges that we come across when doing the work in the communities. But those challenges, we must also be aware that they are also affecting us emotionally, physically. So if we have platforms whereby we talk about those issues and a way to make sure that we solve those issues, make sure that your psychological wellness is in a state that you will be able to engage further and be able to feel that this is a free space whereby your issues are also being put as a priority. Not just the work you do, but also your personal space should also be prioritized for you to be able to be to execute some of the work in the Environmental Justice Network. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Katlego, for your courage and your bravery and for sharing those deeply personal reflections that I think if we all share, we'll find they may be extremely personal, but they are shared across environmental justice movement by women activists. Thank you so much. And I wanted to ask if you've caught your breath there, being a leader in your organization and engaging with authorities or mines or perhaps the municipality, have you felt any resistance as a woman leader from your organization or your community, or when you engage with the municipality on an issue? And what's the response been like from the people who your community engages with when you bring up issues or challenges faced by women? Have you felt that there's a resistance to hearing and to listening, or do you think there's a people are receptive to listening to issues that you've that you can bring to them.
Yes, thank you. But what I will say is that maybe the space that we engage on these issues is not enough. I wouldn't say I feel that they give a listening ear to the issues or they address the issues, because what I will say in terms of the mining campaign, we speak about the women in mining, whereby they should have a same position as men, but we still have those kind of issues that are not addressed. You'll find that women need to have sex before getting a certain position at work. So in terms of addressing this, it's not only in about the mining companies, but in other departments like the government or the municipality. We still have challenges whereby women need to maintain certain duties so that they can get positions in the departments. So I don't think maybe the space for addressing those issues with the relevant departments are not enough. And I think we should maybe have a way in which then we address those issues in terms of raising awareness on campaigns around issues of equality in terms of the workplace and other departments. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Katlego. There's so much support being sent to you in the chat. If you're able to stay with us, there might be some questions for you afterwards, but thank you very much for sharing your story and your experiences.
Thank you. Thank you.
Our next speaker is Nomfundo Mukaba. Nomfundo is the co-founder of the nonprofit organization Waste for Change, a woman-led organization that advocates for the realization of environmental rights through the collection of waste based in Durban, South Africa. Nomfundo was part of the 2019 Rights and Remedies cohort, and she was also nominated as an unsung hero by Sunday World in 2022. Nomfundo, I also had the opportunity to spend a few days with you at Groundworks Environmental Justice School earlier this year, which was just wonderful. And it's lovely to see you again. Actually, I can't see you quite at the moment. I hope you are there. There, Nomfundo, you are there. Are you able to turn your camera on or speak to us for a bit? We've still got you, Katlego. I'm going to actually. Nomfundo, are you there? Nomfundo? I think we're also just struggling with some network issues. Nomfundo, if you could, I'm not sure if moving around might help. We heard a little bit of audio then, but then you disappeared again. Keep trying, I'm sure we'll get through. Okay, I think Nomfundo might be rejoining the meeting and we will definitely get her back. But let me just check if Toko is with us. Okay, all right. Our next speaker is Toko Mtambo. Toko is the secretary of the Snake Park Bambanani Cooperation. Her organization has worked tirelessly in trying to tackle the issue of abandoned mine dumps and tailing dams in her community. Not only is her organization pioneering various methods to deal with the legacy of mining in her community, but they're also involved in progressive projects aimed at rehabilitating the degraded land. Toko was part of our 2023 Rights and Remedies cohort. Toko, we're so happy to have you with us. And perhaps you could start giving us a little bit of background about your journey, what led you to becoming an environmental activist, and tell us a little bit about Bambanani as well, if you're able.
Hi, Danny. How are you?
Hey, lovely to hear your voice again.
Yeah, thank you for inviting me here. Can I please just share my presentation?
Of course, please do. Matt, will you assist with the settings there? Yes, we were expecting.
Okay.
Excellent.
So you can all see my screen, right?
We can see it. It's not on presenter mode, but it's good enough. If you're able to, perhaps on the right-hand side, the format background, if you can exit that little box, it'll increase the size a bit.
All right.
Beautiful. Thank you.
Okay. Hi, everyone. My name is Toko Lemtambo. I'm from Snake Park, Soweto. I'm an environmental activist and a founder of Bambanani, which is an NGO that was formed last year. It's an cooperative that was formed last year. When forming this a corporation, it's because where we come from in Snake Park, there's a tailing mine dump that contains radioactive chemicals such as your uranium, arsenic, copper, and lead. And the tailing has caused a lot of environmental degradation around the community, as you can see in the pictures there. That is me and the corporation members. We are working on the tailing, doing what we called phytoremediation. So phytoremediation, it's a plant-based technology that uses plants to clean toxic soil. So we were using sunflowers to clean, to remediate the soil. Why we chose sunflower is that sunflower has been proven to be an hyperaccumulator. And it was even used in Japan in 2011 when they had tsunami. So when they had tsunami, they found out that their nuclear power station leaked and their soil was dirty. They couldn't grow anything on the soil. So they used sunflowers to clean the soil. So we use sunflower to clean soil on the tailing mine dump. So the problem is that this tailing, it contains very, very, very toxic chemicals. You'll find that farmers who are farming adjacent to the tailing, they have animals who are dying. They've got animals that are disabled. Whenever you're trying to plant something, you cannot even produce vegetation because of our soil in our residential houses. It is mixed with this soil from the tailing. So this is happening because the tailing is not maintained at all. It is not maintained at all. It has no vegetation, as you can see here. It was us planting sunflowers on the tailing, trying to make it different, to prove that sunflowers can actually remediate the soil. And even though we cannot stop the dust from coming into our houses, but at least the dust will be clean. So yeah, that is what I do in Snake Park. That is what we do in Bambanani. So this is the picture of the tailing as a whole. You can see how the seepage goes through the community, how it goes down to the community on a daily basis, especially when it's raining. You'll find acid mine drainage flowing down the community, the sludge. So it's causing a lot of havoc. So Snake Park community is listed amongst the 2 million people living close to mine tailings left by the gold mine rush of 1886. So Soweto lies in a basin to the south and southwest and directly below the mines of the Central Rand, from Langlachter to Crown Mines in the east through Durban Dub Mine. So This tailing was owned by the Durban Roodepoort Deep Mine, which operated centuries ago. So the tailing was sold to Mintails Limited, which assumed its full responsibility and environmental management and rehabilitation around 2017, around in 2007, up until it became liquidated and they could no longer maintain the dump. So the dump was like one of the 6,000 abandoned mine dumps in South Africa. And it caused a lot of problems around it, oh, not only in Snake Park, but in surrounding neighborhoods, like in Bramfisher, in Tepiso. Mostly you'll find that when you come from Bramfisher, the people will just recognize you because you'll be so dusty. Your hair will be full of dust and stuff. So we experience dust storms. So why is this important? This is important because the tailing, as I've said, it contains highly radioactive chemicals like uranium, which can break into radon gas. And radon gas can cause lung cancer. It can cause miscarriages. So when you are a pregnant woman and you're exposed to this radioactivity and you happen to inhale this, you're able to give birth to children with cerebral palsy. So we have kids with cerebral palsy in Snake Park, kids who are born with deformities, they have mental disorders. Others cannot walk, they cannot talk, they cannot do anything because they don't have posture and balance because of their parents when they were pregnant. They inhaled this radioactivity in their womb. So this is affecting women in a very negative way. And you'll also find mostly children who have asthma, wheezing chest, lung cancer, and also we have people who are living in nebulizers, people who are living in oxygen machines, especially people who are living in the Rivali community. So this is important, the phytoremediation that we're doing. It is important to us because it's also some advocacy to fight for the right of especially women. You cannot just give birth to kids with disabilities because of some negligence of a company that failed to take care of the tailings. So the tailings have caused so much harm, especially when it comes to social and social legacy and challenges. So when was it last of last year, there was a story of Zamazamas in Krugersdorp, whereby there were women who were raped because of these abandoned tailings. So you'll find that these tailings that we have, you'll find many informal settlements around them. So people are settling around or near these mine dumps, which today it creates a lot of social problems and have since resulting in illegal mining performed by so-called Zamazamas and scavenging for gold concentrates from closing mining activities. So these informal settlements continue to pose challenges to town planning and services the local municipalities provide. Criminal activities have been recorded in these areas due to limited security by authorities such as the police and other law enforcement agencies. So in these tailings, there's no fencing, there is no signposting, there is no security. So the signposting that you see now, it was just put because of Bambanani. When we started doing phytoremediation and we got exposure we did an article with Sunday Times and they saw that we are doing something and they want to come back and remind the area. So that is when they came and they put this signposting telling us not to come closer to the tailing anymore, not to do phytoremediation to the tailing anymore because they might lose their safety certificate, something like that. So not instead of them actually coming back to Bambanani and saying, you know what, we understand that you're doing phytoremediation, let us actually work together in putting enough vegetation on the tailing and let us stop this harm together. But no, because they want to remind, and the government always puts profits before people. They've put this sign and restricting us to no longer go to work on the tailing as community activists. So the challenges that we have, particularly around this thing, is that we are fighting against private ownership. We're fighting against private ownership of land. And this was an ownerless mine dump, and it was our responsibility for decades and for years. Many kids have been born with cerebral palsy. We cannot even plant vegetables because our soil is dirty. Many people have died because of asthma, lung cancer. They're living in oxygen machines. We are like the owners of the environmental degradation, but we cannot do anything to fight these people because now it's private land. Now they've sold the dump to another mining company that says, you know what, we are gonna do remining after 5 years, meaning the community of Snake Park will have to suffer more for 5 years now going forward because of profits. So now we are suffering the consequences of the waste. They're remining the waste. So liquidations are legislated under the Companies Act, limiting the Imperial DA in enforcing closure requirements in liquidated mines. So Mintails and the Central Gold are examples of mine operation placed under provisional liquidation without adequate financial provision for proper mine closure. So now we're trying to get, actually what we're doing now, we're trying to get legislative instruments for us to enforce them in terms of monitoring this mining company. But as we're busy doing so as Bamanani, we found that the MPRDA is biased towards marginalized people because it favors more the people who are remining the waste because they don't even have to apply for a remining license. So this is the challenge that we have because now they bought the dump, they have the mining license, and where does it put us as community activists? Where does it put us as women? Nowhere, because now the mining is continuing, whether we like it or not. So what I will say is that what we can do as civil society in terms of supporting the work that we do as ecofeminists, supporting the work that we do as environmental activists is there can be a way or a powerful way to contribute to both environmental sustainability and gender equality. And these are some of the ways that they can help. Point number one is to educate yourself, to learn more about feminism, to learn more about environmental justice, climate change, and issues of ecofeminists that are passionate about, issues that has to do with mining, post-mining, the stuff that is happening around Snake Park. Because most of the people, when we started to do awareness and campaigns, they didn't know what is radiation. They didn't know what is a tailing mine dump. They only know this is in Thabamhlophe. You know, so when you educate yourself and you teach people that what are these how harmful are these chemicals from the tailing, so it makes people more aware. Because now Pan African Resource, the new owners of the mine dump, they came back, they did a community training meeting whereby they promised people jobs. So they're trying to buy people that we're going to do remining. You guys are going to be rich. You're going to have jobs. It means development for Snake Park. But no, people, they don't understand that it doesn't work like that. You know, so people need to be educated. There used to be more education in order to train people about these uranium tailings, about the legislative instruments that they can do to fight for their communities. Because there are many communities who are going to be like Snake Park now if they don't fight, if we as Snake Park, we don't fight this reclamation of waste. Amplifying voices, share the work and voices of ecofeminists on social media in your community. This will help for awareness and support of the causes, and support environmental justice organizations. Like we had a problem in terms of funding, funding of sunflowers and stuff. We had a lot of problem in terms of being funded as Bamanani. It was a struggle for us because people just thought, no, you guys are crazy. What are you doing? Are you doing mining? What are you going to do with the metals that you're extracting from the sunflowers? Who's going to fund this? You know, it became a challenge for us, but because of the passion of being an activist, a passion of making a difference in your community, you have to push. You know, that is why factory remediation, we took it as something that can be sustainable in terms of training people as agripreneurs, not only in factory remediation, but we can train people in terms of bee harvesting, to learn more about honey making, to learn more about oil making in terms of the sunflower, and to also start their own farming business. So by cleaning the soil, we're able to build agriculture in townships, in Snake Park. So we cannot do that because our soil is dead. So we need to fund these movements, because now these people, they want to clean the dirty soil. So why can't you fund them with at least a little bit of sunflowers, or maybe stipend to get some agricultural course or a sitter course around agroecology? Advocate for policy change. We need to advocate for policy change, because now, you know, the big words that are coming out, your NEMA, your MPRDA, the duty of care. When we talk to communities like old people, they're like, what are you talking about? We don't understand these things because they're not transparent. I know them because I'm the graduate of the R&R. I know these things. But going back to the community, they don't know these things. That is why it's so easy for them to be vulnerable and for mining companies to take advantage, because they don't even know that there must be a public participation meeting. They don't even know that there must be something like, you have to be an interested affected party, go to to their website and register on those things. How do we to bring those things, like the polluter must pay? You know, they don't know those things. That is why it's easy for mining companies. They can come back and say, you know what, this thing has been causing a lot of environmental degradation in your township. Yes, we agree, but it was not us, it was Mintails. It Mintails was liquidated. Now we are coming back. We want to remind, and we cannot do anything for you guys, because Mintails is the one who made you guys sick. It's not us. We cannot do anything for you. Now we want to remind this, and we're going to remind it after 5 years, and you cannot do anything to control us. So we need to find a way to advocate for policy change. And what else? Sustainable living, as I said, in terms of agroecology, conserving energy, supporting eco-friendly products and stuff, attending events and workshops like this webinar. If you can also have more of these webinars to learn from each other. I was inspired by Katleko's presentation, and I think if you can have more of these online workshops, like activists learning from each other more, and how do we actually mitigate these issues that are causing so much havoc in our communities. And actually supporting women in leadership, it's very hard. You know, when I was working in Bambanani, I had two break-ins, two times people, thugs, they broke in my house because they thought maybe I had money, I had funding. They would see the tools that we're using on the tailing, and the tools were stored in my home because we don't have an office. So people would come and be like, yo, these people are working on the tailing, meaning they have money and stuff. And I was a target. I couldn't go anywhere because now I was a target. They thought maybe I had money to rehabilitate the tailing, or maybe the tailing is giving me some sort of something, some shankura. Even now when there was signpostings, there's a group of people who came and you're like, no, Togo, we see that there are signpostings. Do you know anything about this? Blah, blah, blah. And I'm not even protected by anyone. I'm not even protected by the mine company at all, because now they're like, a sunflower activist, you went there on your own. So how do you want us to protect you? You went there on your own. So I think we need more support for women leaders, and we need more protection for women leaders. And we have to get involved more in community projects and to focus more in environmental sustainability. So you can imagine if now I just give up and be like, okay, sharp, they've put on the signpostings, they're gonna go ahead and do remaining anyway, fine, Bambanani, no, let's just leave this thing, our cause will be dead for nothing. And you can still fight these people, because we are anti-remining, we are for rehabilitation. Rehabilitation must be now. If ever they want to remine, they must do it in a right way. They must show us what good would they do different than the damage that were caused by the Mintails. They must try to explain more depth into the community, that how will this remaining actually benefit the people of Snake Park. Yeah, I'm done, Danny.
Wow, Toko, thank you. I must say, what an incredible presentation, and your passion and your energy is just, it's giving me so much energy myself. It's giving me life. Thank you for explaining exactly how the impacts of the legacy of mining in your community deeply impact women and women differently from men. You know, the burden of caring for children who are not able to take care of themselves, that will be the mothers of the households who do that. And for fighting You know, and what you look at those landscapes in your photos and you think, you know, the courage that it took for Bambanani and yourself to design a project, to think about a solution, to try start working with it, only to be thwarted by the mine tailing being sold and the new owner wanting to remine and now excluding you from your project. But incredible to hear your journey and your activism and your energy. You're getting so much support in the chat as well, Toko. And there's some questions as well, but I'm going to come back to them at the end if you don't mind, Toko.
No problem. Thank you so much, comrades. Sharp.
What incredible work. Love to hear it. Okay, Nomfundo, are you back? Just to remind everybody, Nomfundo is the co-founder of Waste for Change, an organization, a woman-led organization that advocates for the realization of environmental rights through the collection of waste in Durban. And Nomfundo did Rights and Remedies in 2019, and she's also been a part of Environmental Justice School at Groundwork this year. Nomfundo, let's see if your audio is working. We'd love to see your face as well, if that's possible. And thank you, noted for the raised hands. We will have a Q&A after we've heard everybody's voices. We are noting all those hands. Nomfundo. Can you speak a little bit more? Let's see if it's coming through.
Hi, Janelle, can you hear me?
Yes, that sounds great.
Awesome, thank you so much and thanks for your patience. I did have a presentation, but I'm bummed because of the connection. So I'm on my phone right now, but thank you so much. First and foremost, I'd really, really love to thank one of the person who inspired me to be part of the R&R alumni, which is Precious Mazibugo, who recommended me back in 2019, and I don't think I've ever looked back. So I'm based on the south coast of Durban in KwaZulu-Natal, co-founded with Precious Mazibugo, an organization called Waste for Change. I think after the R&R training, I hit the ground running and we didn't look back. We started identifying illegal dump sites because we could tell there was an increase in the illegal dump sites. So we thought, why not take upon and lead the initiative? So my niece and I started identifying illegal dump sites. We started searching the internet for biobank centers that are close by. We also realized that was a major problem in any community-based initiative in this community, because biobank centers were far. One of the landfills as well was very far, so they had a rotational service for the community, so it would come once the waste is not being picked up. So hence they started, you know, mobilizing other women all along the Mbele, which is not a registered entity but a sister entity to Waste for Change, which focuses on improving the lives of unemployed mothers through waste management initiatives. So we have a holistic approach to addressing the issues of unemployment amongst mothers by focusing on waste management as a means of generating an income. We not only provide economic opportunities, but also promote environmental sustainability. So we realized when we looked at the displacement of women again in this whole process, women are considered to be homemakers and caregivers. So their participation becomes very minimal in the space, in community basis. Or we have older women who have kids that are able to take care of themselves. So we also saw a gap of childcare being major support for women to participate in such processes. So we this initiative as well started having a mobile childcare space where we were supported by Durban Angel Network with developmental toys that kids could play with while we attended to illegal dump sites. Considering we are in a community that is dual leadership, we had a traditional leadership and the municipality. So Attending to traditional leadership means that we had to have a male counterpart representing us. Also for the counselor who was now female. So this created a major issue because the female counselor wasn't supportive of our initiative, but now inviting us to have a conversation with the traditional leadership became a political thing. So we didn't have much support from the structures that may be, but we did attend your war rooms and other community meetings for us to sort of advance in the space. Luckily, we started because we could see through the transition from Waste for Change, which was a collective community initiative, to now zooming into the displacement of women and their vulnerabilities, meant we could see the stereotypes, we could zone in on the stereotypes and the biases, because accessing resources and funding was very hard because I'm a mother who's unemployed, so I'm going to prioritize if it's I'm going to invest in the compliance of my NGO, or is it I'm taking care of my home. So priorities also came there. It was time consuming, the red tapes, and it was very administrative. And the gender disparities in employment opportunities, we saw that a lot of males were in this space in senior positions, and then women were ground feeders. So we also wanted to address how do we formalize women participating in these conversations in the waste management sector. We also think it's very important for us to advocate for the career and development of women in this sector, again, because we consider to be homemakers and caregivers. So it then limits us. And then the question of masculinity comes in because women are not considered to be doing technical work. We also saw a major issue in the lack of safe working conditions for women. The area that I'm in, because of the increase in the alien plantations were growing higher, finding body, mutilated bodies. So mutilated kids were raped and disposed in these. Health of women and their safety was a question in these community, because we have one police station that filters to 12 VDs. So even the forum could not even participate in such thing or even bring the voice of women, because now women were excluded from participating in forums because she's at home taking care of the home and not outside at night doing the security job. So again, I think there's a bigger issue in the environmental space in addressing the safety of women and perhaps having private securities that are just woman-led, woman-owned, that would really speak to the issues of women. Because again, if I'm being threatened, which I have experienced an issue where I was threatened by a CEO of a chemical emitting company in my community, who threatened me to get out of these communities, suspended me. So now it also addresses my individual safety. Again, sometimes this is why most women don't participate, because she's looking at, I cannot compromise or impede my safety and go and fight people that have higher power, that have big pockets. So our approach really is to create something that is community-led for women through donations and creating our own revenue through recycling initiatives. And I think that's just about a way to go, because whilst we clean these illegal dump sites, we get a space to talk, to reconnect with each other, to give power to each other, to be in solidarity of our vulnerabilities as women who are mothers. So I really think such things where I'm happy again for the likes of EJF, who are supporting organizations that are not registered, so they grow with these organizations. So there's definitely something within EJF that could expand in supporting unregistered entities in the communities that are community-led. So it also in sort of will encourage transparency in communities in society. I think through our project, we've been able to address that a displaced community. With that being said, thank you so much. I do have so much for this opportunity.
Oh, Nomfundo, it's so good to hear about your work, and it really resonated with me. You know, speaking about or hearing your experience of tackling patriarchy and not just a structural, systemic, you know, the counselor situation, but also within cultural settings, and the incredible courage that it must take to advance the cause, our cause as women environmental activists in those settings. I must just tell everybody that at the end of Rights and Remedies, we invite a very inspirational speaker often to close off our course. And we've had constitutional court judges or, you know, visionary leaders like Sinegogu Zukulu, and Nomfundo is, you know, on the list of people who we want to inspire activists who go on to not only get involved in environmentally and socially beneficial entrepreneurship, but to speak like you have done, about being a woman and your experience and confronting patriarchy in so many different fields of your life. So thank you, Nomfundo. Really, really great to hear your work. Please do stay on. We've got some questions and we've got lots of solidarity with everybody in the chat. But I now have the pleasure of introducing our final speaker, Dr. Machilo Motse. She is the founding director of Africa Ikalafe Spiritual Health Institute, aptly called Africa Ikalafe, which means Africa, heal thyself. The aim of the institute is to indigenize health and in doing so, build an African consciousness that provides fertile grounds for healing individuals, families, and communities. Machilo has for the last few years facilitated very substantial gender sessions at our Rights and Remedies course. And these sessions have been eye-opening to everybody involved and have created a much needed mental shift for many of our participants who've gone on to implement some of the learnings in their own organizations. Dr. Matse, it's such a pleasure to have you. Thank you so much for sharing your wisdom with us this afternoon.
Okay. Hi, I'm trying to switch on my video. It doesn't look like I'm successful, but I hope that people can hear me. Okay, I'll just continue without the video. Firstly, thank you for inviting me to be part of this very powerful, very moving conversation. Somehow it leaves me sad because it reminds me of these are the same issues that we were dealing with in the 90s when we were organizing as women of this country just before 1994 when we were kind of mobilizing ourselves around policy, women's policy groups, policy that would inform what would become government policy. So listening to the story makes me ask the question, what has changed? But at the same time, I do not want us to dwell on what has changed because it's going to rob us of celebrating the small and the big victories that women, the three women who have spoken, have made. So I guess we are talking about deeply entrenched systemic discrimination, and therefore the kind of journey is we have to celebrate every milestone we make along the way. So because of pressure of time, instead of sharing what I had prepared, I'd like to respond to the presentations that have been shared so far. Firstly, I want to just thank Katleho from the depth of my heart for sharing her personal story in that way. And when I hear her talk about lack of water, access to healthcare facilities, This is the same thing that we have been talking about all along. But I want to put in an issue here that we need to think about is it doesn't matter even if we were to get a woman president tomorrow, sexual division of labor is still going to be there. So we have to think about what are the things that we need to change that disrupt the current sexual division of labor. Because if we don't dismantle that, if we do not disrupt that, women become overburdened by working in communities, by transforming communities with very little support, very little material support, very little psychological support, and their lives are in danger even. So they become overburdened with that. And of course, when we talk about dismantling the notion of sexual division of labor, the notion of women as homemakers, it's a great thing, but it's problematic because then we continue to carry the burden alone. So now what is the solution? The solution is, if you look at the reports about fatherhood in this country, there are lots of reports about absent fatherhood. What are we going to do about that? How are we going to change that? I'm doing an online course at the moment. It's a global online course on African spirituality of childbirth. This morning I was preparing a module on childbirth rituals. And then within that module, there was an emphasis on the role of men. So now the question is, who initiates boys into men? What are the challenges that single mothers who raise boys face? I think it's something that we have not dealt with. Challenges that single mothers who raise boys are facing, because you may raise your boy in your house, but your boy is shaped by what is happening in the public space, what is happening on social media, what is happening in entertainment, what is happening at school. So somehow we don't raise our boys alone. And therefore we have to think about how we are going to change those institutions that are raising boys. The sad thing also is that in this country, we have an increasing number of boys who die in initiation schools, as an example. What is the curriculum of the boys' initiation schools? What are they taught? Are they taught to be responsible? Are they taught, is there any program on teenage fatherhood, for instance? When we speak about fatherhood, we never speak about teenage fatherhood. We never have spaces where we prepare boys, kind of about the dangers of having babies when they're still young. And just listening to Katleho as well. A few weeks ago, I was talking to women in corporate, dealing with a program we called Corporate Womb. And the Corporate Womb essentially is questioning what, even if we have policies on reproductive health for women in the workplace, but those policies are not aligned to women's bodily rhythms. To succeed in the workplace as a woman, you have to suppress your feminine being. You have to suppress. You know, it was interesting to listen to one of the women who said that she had even gotten used to manipulating her menstrual cycle in such a way that the menstrual cycle does not extend over 3 days. And if possible, it should happen during the weekend. Because if she misses work, or if she doesn't perform because of something that is natural, menstruation is natural. But then the workplace has got no space to make sure that women who are going through what is natural are supported. And just to hear Rekeho also talk about the miscarriages. I worry about the notion of pregnancy as a duty. I worry about how our culture, religion, whatever, is kind of saying that to prove that you are a real woman, you must have babies and many babies. There is no space for a woman, for instance, who doesn't have to be a baby, who doesn't want to have a baby. And there is also even more pressure for women who only have girls. If you only have girls, you have pressure to give your husband a son, even though we do not have Y chromosomes. You know, the Y chromosomes comes from a man, but we remain in under a lot of pressure to produce boys. So as I listen to Katleho talking about miscarriage and twins, obviously I'm putting in a psychological lens, but I'm also putting in an African spiritual healer lens. And I'm wondering what kind of support did Katleho have to deal with that? That you lose so much, but still you are expected to get up and work and go to work. There is no space, there is no room to mourn. I want to just say to thank Katleho for that. And I'd like to offer my time to engage with her and offer spiritual counseling for her in terms of what she went through, because I think it's the least I can do. Somehow I feel that I cannot listen to the story and not do something about it because it's in my area of work. So beyond this, after this, if it's okay, I offer my time to provide support for what Katleho has gone through. And then Togo, I just want to thank Togo Zili for the power, for the education that she has given us. Again, her life is at stake. So now my mind, usually when I'm listening to people, I often say, so what do we do? What do we do about this? And I'll listen quite carefully to Togo Zili's last slide, which I think we should go back to and identify the kind of support that we can give to Togo Zili and her group in the powerful, powerful work that that they are doing. And somehow I'm thinking, how can we rally around Snake Park community? How can we rally? It's a drop in the ocean, it's okay. But how can we escalate the work that they are doing? How can we make it public? Even if it's a small community, how can we make it public? And I'm wondering if we shouldn't even think about perhaps approaching a university in terms of doing collaborative work on the impact kind of mind dumps on pregnancy. To hear that there's a lot of kids who are born with cerebral palsy, and we don't know. We are not doing anything about it. So I guess as from today, Togo, when I pass a mind dump, I'm going to look at it with a different eye. Based on the education that you have given us today, I will not look at the mind dump and not think about what you have shared today. And I feel like perhaps one of the ways we can do, local government elections is coming in 2026. We can work around Snake Park and the work that Togo Zili is doing as a case study. That's one thing. It could be research. It could be mobilizing around local government that's coming in 2026. So of course, government is biased towards people who buy mining dams. There is so much noise in the world at the moment about climate change. and the people on the ground, like the work that Katleho and Thokozile and Nomfundo are doing, has to be brought out into the open, because that's essentially the building blocks of the work on climate change. And then Nomfundo, you know, I like the name Waste for Change, you know, because sometimes names make you think. And again, you made me reflect on the notion of how can we even become effective homemakers in a capitalist, racist, sexist society? Because South Africa is still a capitalist, racist, sexist society. And it's interesting that in the story that you shared, the woman who's a councillor, that's why I'm saying that we could have a woman president tomorrow. Until such time that you change the culture of work. And I want to say, if you look at the current political landscape, what is happening politically now, politics, in fact, patriarchy has reasserted itself strongly into party politics. And when you look at the picture that's been going around on social media about leaders of MKP, it's a boys' club. We're dealing with boys' clubs. You know, men, black men, have reasserted patriarchy back into politics. And somehow women, and because women are no longer as strongly mobilized and organized as we were pre-1994, it's easy to take power from people who are not strongly organized. Tenjiwe Mtintso, who was once a chair of Gender Commission, once spoke about, you know, the notion of swart gevaar. Right now, we are facing men gevaar. Men have taken over politics for their own egotistic desires. Their notion of power is power over. Their notion of power is not power with people. And I don't care who says what. I do not believe that at this juncture, any politician is concerning themselves with the people, because of the conflict that is within the political space. So that's the biggest challenge that we're facing. So we need to organize ourselves and perhaps try and find a solution to that. And finally, beyond gender consciousness raising, there is a need for massive systemic change. But South Africa is not an entity on itself. South Africa is part of the continent. South Africa is part of the world. If you look at what is happening around the world at the moment, you will understand that the conservative fundamentalists seem to be gaining power, seem to be gaining ground. And the motive is profit. The motive is ego-driven, and the motive is power over others. So when Nomfundo was talking about gender disparities, I wanted to say, I was just thinking about what is happening at the moment. I mean, what the kind of lashing out of Julius Malema is a good example of somebody's ego that feels truly attacked. And therefore, we need to be thinking about different kind of political leadership. But somehow, this is my view. Usually when things fall apart, I often feel that it's a good thing, that maybe it's not necessary to fix the mess that's going on. Maybe we should just let the mess go on. But the challenge is, are women ready to lead when that time, when the cookie crumbles, Are there women who have a positive consciousness ready to lead? Right now, if you stick your neck out as a woman, you'll be attacked for being born female. Kamala has been attacked by Trump, like some serious sexist trivial coming out towards Kamala because she's a woman. And this is something that is happening all over the world. So these are the challenges that we are facing. And again, I want to say, just to thank you. Thank everyone for the work that they do. I have moved out of the gender equality space because I felt that I no longer have a stomach for it. There's something in it that just kills my soul. Maybe it's because I've been working in the space for too long. Maybe because I have several episodes of burning out, and therefore it's my way of protecting myself. But then when I hear what I have listened to today, I can't pull back. I have to step up. I have to step in. I have to do something. So what I have offered is at least the least I can do. Thank you.
Thank you for such generosity, Dr. Motse. I think everybody can see how valuable your wisdom is to our participants within Rights and Remedies, but then also to all the other people who get to experience you on many different platforms through online courses or books, or, you know, I watched your TED talk today, and I think all of our speakers today have really just expressed the need for your services and your wisdom. And to me, you really embody both the speaking truth to power, but then also not beating around the bush with your method of delivery. And it's so refreshing and so energizing. And I'm sorry to hear you have had burnout in this sector, but we're so grateful to have had you help us shape our gender response and to integrate it into our work in the environment as well. So we really are so grateful for your input and wisdom. I've actually just been told that we have one other activist who's managed to fit us in despite having classes. We've got Jabu Makubo. Jabu is the chairperson of the Mabola Alternatives Committee that advocates for the exploration of sustainable socioeconomic opportunities in the community. She's been the source of information in her community in relation to proposed mining in the Mabola protected environment. And because of this role that she plays and the very divided community she's from, because of this, she's had to navigate so many threats and intimidation by some of the community members. In 2022, Jabu was also declared an unsung hero by Sunday World. And we're so grateful to have you, Jabu. Are you able to try on your camera or to see if we could hear your audio?
Yes, afternoon, everyone. I hope you can hear me.
Perfect. So nice to have you with us, Jabu. Thank you for fitting us in with your busy schedule.
Yes. My apologies for being late, but I think I'm going to just share my experience as an activist on the ground.
That's perfect. Perfect. Yes. And we've got about 10 or so minutes left, but in your own time.
Okay, thank you. Okay, as you already said, that I'm Jabulisile Makubu, and I'm from Gromuk Farm 93, which is at Ward 5 of Dr. Pixlika Isagaseme in Mpumalanga Province. And our vision, as Mabola Alternatives Committee says, is to maintain and use natural resources wisely, working together to achieve one goal and build a happy community for a better future. But it is very, very much difficult to achieve it, but we keep on trying. I'm going to start by the issues that I'm facing on the ground is, as a woman. The first challenge is that we are living under Mabola protected area, but there are mines that are operating. And at the same time, they do not consult the community properly. And the worst thing is that they are destroying our area. For an example, during rainy seasons, it is very, very much difficult to move in and out of the farm. One of the things that happened, there was a family that they lost a family member, and it was very raining during those days. Even there, the car from the mortuary was unable to take the body of the deceased where they were supposed to, and they end up lifting the body of the deceased very far. And community members were expecting to help those family to transport the body of the deceased. And the other problem is that leaders on the ground are not assisting in having solutions. For an example, we expect that our ward councillors and also members of the municipality can support us, but they are not doing that, including the people from DMRE. According to my experience, it seems that they are on the side of the miners, because most of the time when you try to communicate with them, they just keep on saying the things that we don't understand. Maybe like saying we are going to come and check, and they just take long to come. And even when they come, they will say, no, this thing is not going to be solved by us. Maybe you need the Department of Water and Sanitation. So they just keep on us not getting the answers, and they keep on pointing each other. When you move to the Department of Water and Sanitation, they will point to the DMRE. And then when you move to the DMRE, maybe they point the municipality. They are just playing that game. And then the other thing that is a challenge is that, as I already said, I am from the farm. So Mabola Protected Area have many farms. And most of the people, they are not educated. That's become a challenge, because I remember one of the scenes where some of the municipality representatives, they said to the community members, Jabu is using the advantage that he can communicate using other language. So he's not saying what he's saying to you. On the other side, she is selling the community. So they said, I may sell out to the environmental team. And even today, when people speak about organizations like Groundwork, CER, Bed Life, they will simply say, where are those Jabu's people who are against the mine? And the other thing that is a problem in our area is that most of the farms are still owned by the white people. So in other times when you need information, maybe they will just not give you exactly what you are looking for. And even some of the mine owners, they are going to say, we are communicating with the farm owners, so, and then they left us behind. And I'm going to move to the challenges that I face working within the environmental justice network. So one of the challenges that make it difficult to me, even though I really love to support my community, especially in terms of environmental issues, but I am doing that voluntarily, which means I must have other things that I do for a living. So I end up unable to attend some workshops and meetings that are part of the environmental issues. And then as we are having an organization, so we communicate, and then I will inform them that, no, team, I'm not going to be able to attend. Can you please nominate someone else who is going to attend? And then what is surprising is that those community members that are part of Mabola Alternatives Committee are also the ones that are suppressing me, because most of the time when they came back to attend some meetings or workshop, and they will say to the community, I was just going to attend this maybe as Milberg, just because I was sent by Jabu to attend it. So they just create a picture that I'm just forcing them to do what they are doing, and they are not willing to do it. And the other thing that I can mention is that working with the Environmental Justice Network has made me an enemy to many people, and that resulting in my life to be in danger. Because even if the miners are starting to come to the area, some of the people, they said to them, you know what, in this community, we have Jabu Makubu, and you need to know her, because she is selling the community. She is the one that is pushing the environmental justice team to stop the mine here. So that makes me to be afraid of moving freely on the community. And what else that I can say is that I think the problem that we are on the farm, and even the municipality is not taking care of the community, this might be a main cause of causing the division to the community. Because if miners come to our area, so they feel that they are going to change the community, they are going to be the development that our local government is not giving to us. Whereas it is not like that, because they create many, many problems. For an example, there is a mine that is currently operating. So they are just polluting the water. Our municipality is not supplying us with water. We just depend on the water from rivers. So the mine is polluting the water that is near some community members. So, and when they start to realize that, they then start to say, Jabu, can you please help us? And that is very difficult to me, because when they start to have meeting with the miners, they just exclude me, because I'm going to share that information with the environmental justice team. But now they are in trouble. They are expecting me to help them. And when I want to, I try to do a follow-up, you will find that they don't have written agreement. Whatever that they promised them, they were just saying it verbally. So when you just try to find the side of the miners, they will say, no, we just agreed with the community members. Where were you all of this time? And then that's also become a problem. And then lastly, what I'm going to share about a thing that I do as an activist to try to solve all of those problems. I am trying to mobilize relevant information on the ground, maybe like organizing the meeting, even if I'm going maybe to town with some of the community members who are using the same transport. I just start to share the information, and then some of the people, they will start to ask questions, and then if I have answers, I will respond to them. And then some of the people, they start to understand that environmental justice team, they are not just stopping the mine, but they are trying to protect and help the communities. And then other thing that I normally do, I just try to get support to the community, maybe like writing the letter to the Department of Road and Transport if the road is not well, so they can come and help the community in maintaining it. And since 2022, I think October, I started to volunteer in the local schools, and I was assisting in teaching. So that also helped me to have the opportunity to communicate with the young people in the area so that they can understand what is going on and where they can intervene and what is going to, and how are they going to be affected as the youth in the community. And lastly, what I can share is how I think women working in this space can be better supported. That's a very, very difficult question I ever met, but I'll try to share what I'm thinking. Because most of the time, especially where I am from, most people believe that women are powerless. So they just believe that women's work is to stay at home, take care of the child, and that's all. And even if you are giving a chance to lead maybe an organization or anything, they will just keep quiet and just wait for you to make a one mistake, even if you have just did 10 good things to them. And with just one mistake, they will say, we already said that a woman can not do this. So that's it's a challenge. And then on that one, what I think is going to help the woman is just that our government is owing us a lot. Especially the local government, because are the people that are closest to the community. So they are the one that they can share, and they can just prove to the communities that women can make things possible. And I think the other thing that the government needs to do is to make sure that women's rights are respected and protected, because they can say we are having the same rights, but what we are seeing in the community is that women are always discriminated. Thank you for the time. I think that's all I can share.
Thank you so much, Shabu. That was incredible to hear your experiences, and I love the fact that you have very solid requests or demands for what kind of support you need. And that's very helpful to hear you phrase your requests like that. And it really resonated with me the way you said the pressure as a woman to perform or to be perfect. I think that's something that a lot of us can have experienced. And the ability, you mentioned the ability or the inability to participate in public processes, perhaps because of a gendered role, you not being able to attend meetings or not being able to be invited to meetings. Also, you're echoing the themes that others have spoken about relating to the huge power imbalance between an environmental justice organization and a mine or perhaps a government authority. And also just echoing, you know, issues of safety concerns and household duties, you know, preventing or creating challenges to participate in the environmental justice movement, whether it's through traveling or attending meetings. So thank you for sharing those thoughts. Very, very grateful to hear your voice. I know thank we've you. Gone over a little bit our time, but I think everybody here, I've just been looking at the chat now, and there's so much solidarity and so much support going to our incredible speakers today. I think we've all just We already know that women play an amazing and important and a pivotal role in the environmental justice movement and our response to climate change. And I think we've also heard how it's not just activism, but entrepreneurship. So many of our speakers today have started their own organizations or their own companies that are doing great things in their communities. We've also heard about how women bear a disproportionate brunt of environmental pollution or climate change. I mean, if you think about women often being responsible for collecting water or household duties and how these hardships increase in times of flood or drought. We've spoken about how we face different challenges at women and we need solutions tailored to support those challenges. And we've had a theme to do with safety and household responsibilities, including essential care work for children and that being recognized and for accommodations to be made in order to encourage women to participate in the movement. The Center for Environmental Rights has been engaging with these and we've been thinking about, for instance, how we can encourage or make our courses more accessible to women caring for young children by conscientizing the organizations we work with on issues of gender justice and sexual harassment and continuing to confront the patriarchy in our work together with activists who inspire us. And I just wanted to really express our deep gratitude to our panelists for the bravery and courage and the amazing work that you've done. And we see you and we celebrate your successes and we want to support you in your work. And we hope that, you know, this is the platform where you get to tell us as well about how to shape, you know, our legal response and our support for your organizations and your work. Thank you so much. Katleho, Toko, Nomfundo, Jabu, and Machilo, we are so grateful. I'm going to hand over to my colleague, Mato Mekapa. He's the leader of the Activist Support and Training Program to close our session. And after Matomo, we just have a 2-minute short video, which we will end the session with. Thank you. Oh, actually, my apologies. I meant to ask for some questions and answers. Sorry, Matome. Cedric, your hand has been up. Are you able to unmute and would you like to ask a question or make a comment? Cedric, are you there? I've been seeing your hand coming up from time to time. If you're able to ask a question, great.
Thank you. Yes, sir. Hello, how are you?
Very well, thank Hello? You. Yeah, we can hear you.
Okay, how are you doing? Daniela, is that right?
That's right.
Okay, hi Daniela, my name is Cedric Cortel. I reside in the south of Johannesburg. Okay, I'm from an organization called the Reveille Mining Forum. Okay, and our group is consists of various gender. We have males, females, our group, and each one have their different tasks to perform. Okay. We also do have challenges in our community, and especially regarding health and safety. Our community and the challenges that we do have especially with departments such as Department of Mineral Resources and Energy and trying to get them to listen to our plight and our pleas and the mining companies. And I was listening in on a lady, I think she will know who she was speaking about mine tailings contaminating you know, rivers and dams and you know, I would like to comment on that firstly. The acid mine drainage, we call it acid mine drainage, AMD. Okay, so acid mine drainage is acidic from these mine tailings, right? In our area, we have the Russell Stream, used to be the Boysons River. This river would lead you directly past the Klip River if you guys are familiar with the area, but it eventually ends up in the Vaal Dam. Okay, so all tailings has eventually over the years, because of bad tailings bad tailing management, you contaminated our water system. Okay, people recently is becoming conscious about our water supply from the Limpopo islands. Are still under the impression that you know, we get our water, drinking water, from the Vaal Dam, and if we are talking about water at the same time, you know, we are living right on the main reef. Okay, so I am actually approximately a kilometer away from George Harrison Park. It is on Main Reef Road. That is the area where gold was discovered first in the 1800s. So,
could I ask you to give us your question or your comment? We unfortunately are running out of time for our allotted webinar.
Oh, okay. Yes. Okay. My OGL. Are we protecting communities, but are we protecting the that we are standing on? A sad to me, because our mine shafts and tunnels below us are fully.
My apologies, Cedric. I'm not sure if it's my network or if it's yours, but your voice is breaking up a little bit there. If you'd be able to type your comment into the chat, I would be happy to pass it on to the panelist whose work it involves. My apologies, your sound is breaking up there.
Yes, yes. You're also breaking up on my end. I don't know if it's my, I think it's my network. I don't know. Yes.
Yeah. All right. Type in your question and we'll direct it. Okay.
Okay.
Any other questions for our panelists before I hand over to Matome to close the session? This is your opportunity. I don't see any raised hands. Matome, thank you. Over to you.
Thanks, Danny. I'm not going to waste everyone's time. I think I want to echo what Danny said about extending gratitude to everyone who participated and took their time off to attend this webinar today. I think we had really powerful conversations, and I'm glad that we spoke a bit about some follow-through activities that we're going to do in relation to some of the conversations that we have. And also with us here at the Center for Environmental Rights and at ASNT, we will also be thinking about how do we build on this webinar, this conversation, so that they can filter into our work to make it more meaningful. Other than that, I'm going to leave you guys, but I'm going to make one quick announcement about our Rights and Remedies course. I know that earlier this year, we made an announcement that we are not running the course as we usually run it. This year, we're taking a break and we are doing what we call a year of consolidation, which is essentially extended monitoring and evaluation of the course. We have a number of activities lined up throughout the year. And at the end of the year, we're going to close it off with some outputs from those. But what we are ultimately aiming to achieve is to ensure that in the coming years, we're going to develop a better and more improved rights and remedies course. Look out for announcements on our website and on our social media. Thanks, Danny.
Thank you, everybody. We know that 2 hours of your time is very precious and we are very grateful. I'm going to hand over to my colleagues to just close us out with a little clip featuring some of the activists who've joined us from our Rights and Remedies course. Okay. Thank you very much. Bye.
Ngicabanga ukuthi abantu besimame ba-affect-eka more ngenkinga ye-climate change esibhekene nayo because i-climate change isimo sokuguquguquka kwezulu esenza ukuthi ama-impact wazo ngasho ukuthi like kuba isomiso. So uma komile angeke sibantu besimame angeke sikhone ukuthi silime izingadi zethu sitshale izinto esisebenzisayo daily basis. And mase kunjalo sekufanele ukuthi si-rely kuma-market, kuma-supermarket ukuthenga izinto esisebenzisayo okwenza ukuthi singakhoni ukuzithenga ngoba si especially thina abafazi usually sibuthi unemployed vele esikhathini esiningi and sima-single parent.
Zi-challenges zineyo bafumakazi batangana nazo nganthani ya climate change ndinjisa musi ri tshi khou dzi amba ri nga fhelelwa nga tshifhinga. Bafumakazi a vha ṋewi opportunity nnzhi zwi tshi ḓa kha mafhungo onga a mishumo, u wana mavu ane vha nga kona u ita uri vha kone u ḓithusa khamusi kho lima vha kone u ḓiitela zwiḽiwa u kona u sustaina miḓi yavho.
Njengamuntu wesifazane nayi ke le sikhuluma nge-climate change or environmental justice, njengomuntu wesifazane emaphandleni kuyinto ebalulekile uma sikhuluma nge-climate change ifike manje emaphandleni kuthina kumphakathi emaphandleni. Bengazi abantu ukuthi kambe lokuguquguquka kokushintsha kwezulu kushintshwa yini yona leyo. Kwaze kwaba ngoba sibona amasimu komile, sibona izinto azimili, nayi imayini ifike, konke kwahlangahlangana. Uma kuhlangahlangene sidinga ukuthi abantu saziswe noma sifundiswe ngalokho.
Thank you so much, everyone.
Thank you. Bye.